Hello, and welcome to the TI Precision Lab series on the basics of analog multiplexers. In the first two parts of this series, we discussed four important parameters of multiplexers: on resistance, on capacitance, leakage current, and charge injection, and how they are important when you design data acquisition systems. In this video, we will provide an overview of the four other important parameters of multiplexers, which are bandwidth, channel-to-channel crosstalk, offisolation, and THD+noise. The goal of this series is to understand these parameters of multiplexers and which factors affect them. This video series explains how the parameters listed in an analog multiplexer's datasheet can be used to understand system performance. In this video, we will discuss multiplexer bandwidth, channel-to-channel crosstalk, offisolation, and THD+noise specifications. Specifically, we will see how these parameters are defined and measured. We will also see device-related factors that affect these parameters and limit multiplexer performance. The first parameter we will discuss is multiplexer bandwidth. Multiplexer bandwidth is defined as the range of frequencies that are attenuated by less than 3 dB at the drain pin when an input is applied to the source pin of an input channel that is switched on. The figure shown in this slide highlights the simplified multiplexer model when the switch S1 is on. For the purposes of this analysis, we will ignore the external source resistance of the signal and internal source capacitance of the mux. So the simplified circuit is just a voltage divider created by R on and the load impedance. The load impedance is composed of the reactants CD, CL, and RL. The equations given show the transfer function and the 3 dB cutoff frequency for the multiplexer, where the 3 dB cutoff frequency is given by FC and the input signal frequency is given by F. For lower input frequencies, the impedance of the multiplexer channel is mainly resistive, so the input channel is attenuated by a factor equal to R on divided by RL plus R on, using the standard resistor voltage divider equation. As the input frequency increases, the capacitive reactance of CL and CD will decrease. This reduction in reactance, or load impedance, will cause the output signal to attenuate as more voltage drops across R on, causing less voltage to be supplied to the load. From the equation for the multiplexer 3 dB cutoff frequency, it is clear that the multiplexer's bandwidth depends on the on resistance R on, drain capacitance CD, load capacitance CL, and load resistance RL. Typically, the multiplexer output is interfaced with a high input impedance stage to avoid gain errors. Mathematically, we can say that RL is much greater than RON, so RON in the numerator can be ignored and RL will cancel out. This yields a simplified equation that considers only RON, CD, and CL. Increasing the value of RON, CD, and CL will decrease the multiplexer bandwidth. The graph shown in this slide highlights the MUX36 SO8 bandwidth. The MUX36 SO8 offers a typical on resistance of 125 ohms and an ultra-low drain capacitance of 9 picofarads. When measured with a 50-ohm termination resistor on the output of the multiplexer, the MUX bandwidth is around 450 MHz. This indicates that the MUX36 SO8 can pass input frequencies up to 450 MHz without significant attenuation. In other words, the MUX will have an attenuation of less than 3 dB at these frequencies. The next parameter we will discuss is channel-to-channel crosstalk of the multiplexer. This slide shows the standard setup for measuring this parameter. Channel-to-channel crosstalk is defined as the voltage that appears on the source pin of an off channel when a known signal is applied to the source pin of an on channel. Channel-to-channel crosstalk is measured in dB and given by 20 times the log of the ratio of the crosstalk signal Vout and the source signal applied to the on channel, Vs. Channel-to-channel crosstalk is a frequency-dependent phenomenon. It occurs mainly due to the off-state parasitic capacitances of the multiplexer. Sometimes parasitic capacitances are introduced as a result of poor layout techniques and can manifest as crosstalk. We will now see how the crosstalk phenomenon happens. This slide shows the simplified model of a multiplexer when the multiplexer is configured to measure crosstalk. From the simplified model, you can see that the multiplexer has a parasitic capacitance between the source and drain pins called CSD. CSS represents the parasitic capacitance between two input channels. This could be the capacitance between two input traces that carry the signal, or between the two input pins of the multiplexer. Analyzing the circuit, we can say that at lower frequencies, the impedance from S1 to the output is equal to Ron, while the impedance from S2 to the output is very high, because channel 2 is turned off. As the frequency of the input signal applied to S1 increases, the impedance of the parasitic capacitance CSD becomes lower, and introduces a fraction of the input signal of S1 at S2. Similar logic can be applied for the parasitic capacitance CSS, which directly couples a fraction of the input signal to the off-channel S2 as the frequency increases. In addition to higher input signal frequencies, board layout techniques that reduce stray capacitance can also help with channel-to-channel crosstalk. The graph shown here highlights the MUX36 SO8 crosstalk, which is negative 90 dB at 1 MHz. We will now discuss another important parameter called off-isolation. Off-isolation is defined as the voltage introduced at the output pin of a multiplexer when a known signal is applied at the source pin of an off-channel. This slide shows the typical setup used to measure off-isolation. A known signal is applied to the source pin of the off-channel, and the output voltage Vout is measured. Off-isolation is measured in dB and given by 20 times the log of the ratio of the output signal to the input signal applied to the off-channel. Like crosstalk, off-isolation is also a frequency-dependent phenomenon that happens as a result of the off-state parasitic capacitance of the multiplexer. Off-state parasitic capacitance in turn depends on multiple factors, such as device packaging and pinout, manufacturing and fabrication processes, and board layout techniques. This slide shows the simplified model of a multiplexer when the switch is off. For ease of understanding, let's assume that the source to drain capacitance is the parasitic capacitance connected across the switch when the switch is off. At lower frequencies, the parasitic capacitance offers a high reactance to the input signal, so very little signal is coupled to the output. At higher input signal frequencies, the reactance of the parasitic capacitor CSD is smaller, which allows some of the input signal to be coupled to the output pin of the multiplexer. From the simplified model of the multiplexer, you can see that the off-isolation also depends on load resistance RL, load capacitance CL, and drain capacitance CD, since it forms an impedance network with the parasitic capacitor CSD. A lower load resistance will yield better off-isolation, but it will introduce distortion due to the multiplexer's on-resistance. A larger load capacitance and drain capacitance will also help with better off-isolation, but it limits the multiplexer's bandwidth. The graph shown on this slide highlights off-isolation for the MUX36 SO8, which is negative 90 dB at 1 MHz. Both off-isolation and crosstalk specifications use the terminology adjacent and non-adjacent channels. The term adjacent refers to the physical pins on the device. So for example, in the case of off-isolation, only channel S4 is adjacent to the output D. It is important to note that these terms only refer to the adjacent pins of a package, and not sequentially numbered pins. For example, pins S4 and S5 are not adjacent because they are on opposite sides of the package. Note that adjacent pins on the package will have more parasitic capacitance between them than non-adjacent pins, so adjacent pins will generally have worse crosstalk and off-isolation. Here we show an example of how to predict the signal on an off-channel using the off-isolation specification. In this case, a 1-volt peak 10 MHz signal is applied to channel S1. This channel is turned off and is not physically adjacent to the output pin. Using the off-isolation plot, we find that the off-isolation is approximately negative 79 dB at 10 MHz for a non-adjacent channel. The equation for off-isolation that we introduced earlier is rearranged to solve for Vout. Using the input voltage of 1 volt peak and the off-isolation of negative 79 dB, we find that the output signal is 112 microvolts peak. This slide highlights another multiplexer parameter called total harmonic distortion plus noise, or THD plus N. The total harmonic distortion, THD, of a signal is defined as the ratio of the sum of the powers of all harmonic components to the power of the fundamental frequency at the mux output. THD plus N is the ratio of the sum of all harmonic components and total RMS noise to the fundamental signal. The hardware configuration for this measurement is shown in the schematic. For this measurement, a low distortion input signal is applied to the input of the mux, and the output signal noise and harmonics are measured with a precision digitizer. Note that this measurement is done over a range of frequencies, and the results are used to generate the THD plus N versus frequency curve. Also note that the multiplexer distortion is highly dependent upon the load resistance, as the distortion is the result of R-on flatness versus the input signal creating a non-linear voltage divider. Increasing the load resistance will reduce the distortion. Generally, multiplexers with low on resistance have better THD plus noise. This parameter becomes increasingly important in audio applications because the amount of distortion affects sound quality. For additional information on THD plus N, please watch the OpAmp Precision Lab series on distortion. In the next slide, we will look at an application where the circuit will be affected by distortion. This slide illustrates a multiplexer application where the mux is connected to a relatively low impedance of 500 ohms. For the multiplexer shown in this slide, let's assume that the multiplexer's on resistance, R on, varies from about 120 ohms to 150 ohms due to the R on flatness limitations of the switch. Since the on resistance is changing with the input signal, the gain will also change according to the input signal. This variation in gain versus input signal creates a non-linearity in the transfer function. In this example, the worst-case non-linearity is about 1%. This introduces input signal-dependent distortion and affects the THD. The best way to avoid this distortion is to connect the multiplexer to a high input impedance input when possible. In this case, a non-inverting amplifier would be a better choice, as the input impedance would be very high. We discussed how multiplexer bandwidth, channel-to-channel crosstalk, off-isolation, and THD plus noise parameters are measured and which factors affect them. Stay tuned for the next video, which discusses the details of various system-level electrical overstress protection schemes for multiplexers. Thank you for your time. Please try the quiz to check your understanding of this video's content.